Before we get started with today's podcast, I want you to go check out our next guest, Hakim Tate, a newly released book, The Twins' Adventures, A Day in the Park with Rocky the Dog. Please check that out. You can find that at Kmart, Amazon, and Barnes & Noble. This is Red Zone in the Lab podcast. This is me, Deion Deuce Blackney. I welcome you. This is season two. We're going to have a host of guests discussing entrepreneurship, education, black history, health, movies, family, and of course, sports. But first, welcome back to Red Zone in the Lab podcast with Deion Deuce Blackney. And my guest this week is Hakim Tate, author, musician, producer, community activist, community leader, motivational speaker, and a longtime friend of mine. Man, we talk about going back to the sandbox. We go all the way back to the sandbox, Florida Avenue. My grandmother lived by Hakim and his folks. And that's the only time when I came over there, I was just looking forward to going out there with you and Halim and just shooting on the basketball court. And back then it was a chain net, wasn't it? The little basketball court we had in the little
chain net. So it wasn't nothing like that. Yeah, that sound. It wasn't no whoosh that when them chains. You know, you made that ball. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, man. What you been up to?
Man, I've been good, man, but it's always a great moment when you can take a second to reflect, man. And I was just thinking, you know, the kind of work that I do, man, it took me right back to that neighborhood, that childhood neighborhood. And every chance that I get, I ride past that basketball. Well, it used to be a basketball court there, but it ain't there no more.
Yeah, I think so.
Lady, she was mad because the basketball court was right next to, like, on the side of her house. And so if you missed the ball, you hit her brick wall, but she can still hit that joint because some of the basketball. But always a great time to reflect, man. Childhood was rough, but it prepares you for what prepared me for, you know, for life, you know, for what it was to come. It's been a rough life, but been good though, man. It's been good, you know, it's been good. And it's been good because I felt like childhood prepared us for it, bro. You know, playing with flat basketballs.
Right. All types of weather.
You know, your shot might be a little better. You know, your arms a little stronger. Yeah. So, it was good.
Your family, because I see you, you're so involved in the community. You know, you have your coat drives. You know, you're an author. You're writing books, and it's always about the community. And you got your literacy campaign, and was it War 7 and War 8? So I'm just trying to see, like, what prepared you for that?
Well, coming up, it took that village to raise me, man. My father, he was a big-time producer back in the day. Some of the hits were I Love You, For All Seasons by The Fuzz, Chuck Brown and the Soul Searchers, Salt of the Earth, first album, Blow Your Whistle. The list goes on, but Pops was never really home. You know what I mean? Pops had to sit down time. So yes, I'm a child of a incarcerated parent, you know. Right. But that was during the time that, if you ask me, it was a war against black men and black families, you know. Black men were going to jail at an alarming rate. But, you know, mom was there for a moment, or as much as she could be, but she had a role. She had to, like, every time I looked up, she was going to work just to try to pay the bills. So when you knock on the door, it's for sure, it's probably my older brother or sister saying, yeah, you can come outside or not.
Oh, yeah.
They got homework to do. Yeah. You know, and it'd be those moves where, you know how you want to get outside, you might have to slip out the basement door, you know, come around, you know, walk all the way around the block, because, you know, we lived in Wally Courts, was at the bottom of Trinidad, so you know how that was, man. You had to walk all the way around just to get to where the basketball court, and sure enough, you'd be out there for a good 30, 45 minutes with it. Halim, Hakim, you know, they coming looking for you. But because
people don't know, like, what they see from Trinidad, I'm talking about, like, all four corners of Trinidad, I'm talking about, like, the whole area, like, we talk about from, like, 17th all the way down to Florida, all the way back up to
on all of it.
Yeah. So it's like it was bad. You know what I'm saying? And you and my grandma, you live like right on the other side of Florida Avenue, but still it's like everything it leaked out. So it wasn't, you know what I'm saying? You had to be careful.
Childhood was traumatic, man. And it was traumatic in a sense that I didn't really figure this out. Right now I'm 39, but I didn't really figure this out until now. Like it would be midnights, you know, and we grew up in the 80s, you know, so, you know, I grew up 82. So 82, 86, 87, those time periods. So you knew what was going on with the drug epidemic and the, you know, the crack epidemic and DC being the murder capital and all that kind of stuff. The firehouse, legitimately, you talking about traumatic. Every time you would hear, like it'd be 2 o'clock in the morning, leaving the firehouse. That's all you hear. Window open, breeze coming through, fire truck leaving the fire station. And they were going to pick up somebody that was black. More than likely, 9 times out of 10, somebody was stabbed, shot, killed, or hurt. And that was a traumatic part of my childhood. So every time, you know, I hear an ambulance or something of that sort of fire truck, it brings back those set of memories. Like, dang, you know? So I don't live close to no firehouse now. You know, that was just it. But it took that village. So that's why I'm passionate about giving back to my community, man. You know, your grandmother. If we ain't had no peanut butter and jelly, we ain't had something, those are the times where, you know, hey, look, you my son just as much as my son is. And, man, she'd take me in, peanut butter and jelly, some milk, juice boxes, whatever it was, snacks, you know. She always looked out. So did as mean as Miss Laverne might have seemed, she was a super nice lady. She just ain't like us throwing a basketball court. You know, throwing a basketball against the side of her house.
Right.
Or playing football in her yard, because we did kind of like tear up her yard. I'm sorry, Mr. Laverne. We did kind of tear up her
yard. But it was like you said, it was a village, and the village included your neighbors, your community. Yeah. It wasn't just about, you know, family, because like you said, in the 80s and 90s, you know, it wasn't no easy transportation. You know, it wasn't a lot of, like, lower class black families that had vehicles. It was all metro. So what we had that was accessible to us is our community, our neighbors, and our teachers. Back then, teachers actually cared. You know what I'm saying? They were there for us.
Yeah. So speaking of teachers, it was my I was going to Mila Matilla. I ain't gonna even screw up the first name, but it was Mila Elementary School over on 15th Street. Mm. And I had a third grade teacher named Mr. Morland. White guy, bald spot in the middle of his head, but cool as hell. You know, super cool. And they had an end of the school year trip to Florida, to Disney World and Epcot Center and all that kind of stuff. I don't know if you remember that. I think your cousin might have went too. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think he did. So, but this trip, we couldn't afford it. I mean, that was just flat out.
I mean, it's just,
and it was two of us, you know what I'm saying? So the twins, like, you know, Mr. Morland, you know, He paid for us to go, you know what I mean? And that was one of those things we used to say teachers cared back then. Like, yeah, I don't even know what a teacher's salary was back then compared to what it is now. But on his salary, he paid for me and my twin brother to go, you know, to that Florida trip. So, yeah, it was definitely a village back then. More so than I would, and nothing to slight any teachers that, you know, that's all they're doing. It's the great work that's now, and it's really passionate about the work. About the kids, they have a really tough job to do, especially now during this pandemic. But I can only speak on what I experienced, you know, when I was coming through, and I felt the love from my teachers on the good side and the bad side. Where I had a teacher love me enough to chase me down the hall if I was screwing up. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if the teacher is going to chase the kid down the hall now. You know what I mean? It's just a whole different dynamic. And, you know, my hat's off to the teachers that deal with and navigate through the crises and stuff in the school building. But back then, man, you felt the love for sure.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, even if they wanted to, they probably couldn't based on the rules and
yeah, rules didn't change. You're right.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and just to kind of talk about Haleem, you know, like, again, you know, sorry for your loss. And I didn't really, you know, and I didn't know about it, you know, but like a few months ago, when I friended you on Facebook, I said, man, I see Hakim doing this thing. I was like, let me search his brother. And I didn't. And I was kind of like iffy. I ain't like, man, I ain't want to be like, man, hey, what's your brother been up? Cause you just don't know. So when you reposted a post a few weeks ago, I was like, oh man. So, you know, just talking about Hakim, what kind of impact did he have on you to, you know, to do the things in the community that you're doing now?
Yeah, well, losing my twin brother I think I was 16.
Imagine you and Hakim was the first twins I've ever seen. So it was crazy, you know what I'm saying? Back then, it was something I wasn't used to.
Yeah. Maybe. I can't even tell, man. All the memories and stuff that we had, tricks and booby traps and, you know, just a good time. But losing him at such a young age, it prepared me for the dynamic of what life and death and separation and what you call it, grief and stuff like that. It prepared me at a young age. I was literally like 16 years old. I wasn't nowhere near being an adult just yet. And it just made me feel like I had so much that I wanted to do and not really know how much time I had to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because, you know, like cancer's scary, you know?
Yeah.
And he passed away from cancer. I ain't never let them stick no tubes and needles and all that kind of stuff in me as much as my family encouraged it. Because I just didn't want that to be my reality. And I still don't want that to be my reality. So I just live every day as if it was my last. And I've done that since I was 16 and been blessed to be able to have enough angels and support and mentors around me to be able to make it through whatever challenges that were put in front of me. But at that young age, man, it was like, yeah, all right, cool. I really got to live fast. I really got to live hard. I got to live smart. No regrets. And I've been doing that since 16, man. I just been working. And if I needed to learn something or need to know something, never been afraid to ask a question. So his death really prepared me for life itself and the decisions and the ups and downs and the losses of grandparents and my dad who's moved on, you know, to the other side, and, you know, other family members. So I was able to handle grief real early, man. Yeah. You know what I mean? I didn't get stuck there, but it did cause me a whole lot of hurt and pain. I did get into some trouble when I was a teenager, you know, went to jail a few times or whatever, but, you know.
I mean, for us, man, it's like...
childhood, man.
Yeah, man, the percentage of that not happening, especially where we grew up, is, you know what I'm saying, it's slim, you know what I'm saying, and you got to be lucky to come across one of the good cops or, you know, the good judges, you know, that's going to look out for you and like, you know what, I'm going to give you this chance. But sometimes you don't. Sometimes you got to face that reality and actually, you know what I'm saying, go through those bad consequences, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So it's always a real patient and compassionate approach whenever I have to, get into that law enforcement piece and, you know, enforce the laws that have been written to protect us. Because I've been there, you know, like if you had handcuffs on before, you wouldn't think 3-4 times over about putting them on somebody else. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because it's, you know, having your freedom, removed or taken, that's a big deal, you know, it shouldn't be taken lightly.
Yeah. And to have your, like, just to talk about that part of your life, you know, being in law enforcement and everything that went on, that not just, you know, last year, but, you know, I mean, forever, really. But because of social media, how things have kind of been magnified and, you know, in your peers, how are you able to kind of manage that? You know what I'm saying? Being on that side and then having peers on this side. Actually, you've been on that side. So it's actually, you got to manage yourself too, because you know what it means to be on that other side. Like for me, I was like, man, when I saw it, I was like, man, Hakim, young dude, man. These past few years, because of, you know, everything that's going on, man, how was you able to kind of
Well, I had to navigate it first on, man. That first test, taking an oath and, you know, taking a sworn oath to protect and serve. They put me right back in the neighborhood that I grew up in. You know what I mean? So for me, that kind of played on my intelligence just a little bit, because I was like, well, why would you do this? You know what I mean? Like, you know, like, what you trying to make me out to be? But it grounded me in the sense where it's like, okay, cool. Well, my brothers and sisters, they know who I am. You know what I mean? They know what I'm made of. They remember where I came from. And I haven't changed that. You know what I mean? You know, I've grown, but it hasn't been diverted to a 360. I'm another person. You know what I mean? And so if my family and close friends can see that and believe that, then my hood buddy's good too. You know what I'm saying? I'm the same Hakim, yo. You know, I'm the same Hakim. I still like to drink beers and, you know what I mean, talk trash and, you know, play kickball with flat basketballs, you know. So, right. You know, those things ain't changed. So navigating was easy, you know, but like lately, since this whole, you know, like this whole stuff has been really amplified on social media and it's kind of been a fashion thing. It increased my thought pattern, you know, increased my thought pattern because I'm like, well, if there were more police officers who were in touch with the culture and the struggles of being a black or brown person or being a white person in an urban neighborhood that, you know, because they got struggles too, trailer parks, you know, so being a person of lower means, so to speak, you know, like navigating, this just was like, but we still need law enforcement. We can't have I don't think that we can have a world where, you know, because in my opinion, if it did happen like that, it would be like survival of the fittest.
Like, it'd be like the Purge. Okay. I mean, literally.
Yeah. So we definitely need law and order. But I wish that we just had more people who came from the struggle to take the job. And on the flip side, it's like, man, you see how the media keep on spending it? They discouraging people that look like me and you from wanting to take this job because they would rather have somebody that looks different from us be the oppressor or appear to be the oppressor. No, make it popular. You know what I mean? Make it popular. I went over to Turks and Caicos, which is a 90% predominantly 90% black island. It's always been that way. But they have a culture that they adopted from America, F-12. Like, how you get that over there? Law enforcement, yeah. Almost 100% black. I said, so how you get that? And they ain't out there, you know. So, the cultural things that come from America and its relationship, which is formed for a long time, and rightfully saying, we do have a reason to say that in some instances, but I think we need to flip it and take the approach of let's be the change that we want to see, and being the change, getting in there, you know, and doing the work. Not standing on the sideline and saying, hey, I want y'all to do this, that. Nah. I want to be the one and be like, I'm not going to tell you what I want you to do. I'm going to do it. And I'm going to show you that it can be done. And hopefully you'll pick it up and you do the same thing. You know what I mean? So for every one non-good police officer, there should be, and you notice I didn't put a color to it. Right? Yeah. So for every one non-good police officer, there should be 10 that are good. And they should be in the cars. Or you can make it 50-50, because if a good officer is in the car with a bad officer, then I'm hoping that good officer encourages and makes that bad officer nervous enough to not do bad things that he quits the job and leave. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But we'll never get there if it doesn't become popular for people to take the position, you know?
Yeah, so. You got to care about people's experiences, you know, even for the bad cop, you know, you have to care about his experiences. Like, why are you bad? There's a reason for it. And, you know, you got to listen to it and you got to kind of understand where they're coming from, even if you don't agree with it. Because if you don't, we can't just, like, this is my experience. This is my experience. You got to listen to the other side. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And for the other side, it was good to be able to be in a space to be able to ask those questions and to have officers be. So the question was asked, I say, well, hey, you know, what made you want to come from Oklahoma to come to Washington, D.C. to be a police officer? I asked, a white officer, you know, I leave his name out. And he say, well, hey, you know, I come from a farm family. I got tired of messing with chickens and, you know, this, that, and the other. And, you know, I wanted to get into law enforcement and D.C. was hiring. I said, what do you know about it? You know, he only knew the 8 months of training that, you know what I'm saying? So, but he didn't really understand culturally what was happening in Washington, D.C., the people that he was serving. You know what I mean? And so what I gave to him and helped him understand was like, hey, listen, I want to come home with you one day, you know, to Oklahoma, you know what I mean, to the farmland. And I want to be able to understand what it might be like the police there. And I told him, I said, for me, I would probably have to get used to seeing white men ride around in red pickup trucks with shotguns or AR-15s mounted to the back. You know what I mean? Because quite frankly, from where I come from, we don't do that. If you do right. that, then you on a mission to get, you know
yeah,
what
yeah,
I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. So I ain't going to go get some milk. Yeah.
Exactly. You know what I mean? And so I say on the flip side, like you should be paired with somebody that's from this area, you know what I mean? To really get to understand how we work, how we move. So if you see something, you know, that may be uncommon for you from this area, then you know what I'm saying? You won't if dude, you know, spit in front of you or, you know, cut his eyes at you or, you know, talk trash, it ain't really that he might want to hurt you. He just venting. He trying to get it out. You know what I'm saying? You might not used to be saying that in Oklahoma, but this is how people vent in Washington, D.C., Maryland, and Virginia area. They might pace like they about to do something, but they don't necessarily want to hurt you. So, you know, those type of things. But being in that space, man, it gave me the opportunity to learn a lot from him and for him to learn a lot from me just in that moment because it happened. So I think we're growing as a people. And I said people is like one people, you know, black, yeah. white, brown, you know, and so forth.
So the audience that you usually kind of encourage, you know, they call it motivational speaking, but it's really like an encouragement to a group of people. What type of audiences do you encourage?
Teenagers, you know, okay. like teenagers that's like 19, 20. And then some of those audiences that are in the space where they may be like in their 30s and they're looking to settle down or buy a home or start a business and just really want to be more productive. So, you know, those two different groups, teenagers. So you could just really say from age 12, because 12 is almost like 14 now. They be sharp. They like, they
Yo,
think.
Yeah. Yeah. And I try to tell, you know, a lot of times when I have discussions, you know, with our elders, yeah. I try to get them because it's like we're mediators between them and the younger generation. Yeah. And I try to explain to them, you got to understand what you were doing at 25, I was doing at like 16. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And what I'm doing at 16, they doing at like 12, 13. So like the same thing we was talking about law enforcement, like you have to understand both sides. Like you have to understand, you can't just say, hey, look, you don't need to be doing that. Why you know this and know that? Because they have so much access to it.
Yep. Yeah. So by the time I'm finding now, like, you know, just being out there in the mentoring world and stuff like that and motivational speaking world, like by the time they 14, they got their mind made up. They like, they know that they want to trap, you know what I'm saying? Or they know they want to be serious about the books, you know, and that's at age 14. And so the motivational speaking or the encouragement or the mentoring should really start as early as 9. Because they start to form opinions and their access to YouTube and movies and everything else. It's such a fast paced world, man. Mm-hmm. You don't have time to wait because we can lose them just like that, man.
Yeah. So real estate, let's get into some business. Real estate. Dang. What is the market looking like? Because I see you out there, you know, helping people accomplish their dreams. And, you know, when you post those videos and stuff like that, is encouraging. Especially, yeah. you know, people, like you said, people that look like us able to go and actually purchase something that they can say that they own.
Yeah. So real estate, man, I got into real estate probably about 11 years ago now. And I got into it on the business side. I've been a homeowner for probably more than 15 years now. But it all came into the building wealth and understanding change and building a community foundation and a sense of pride for us. You know what I mean? Knowing where our money. So it ain't really about the money so much for me when it comes to real estate. It's like beating the odds. It's like, yo, you don't think you can, but here's the plan. So some of my clients, they start out and it's 9 months to a year before they actually ready to purchase a home, you know, because they got to get this off their credit. They got that all off their credit. And sometimes that process say, hey, look, okay, cool. You need to have a budget. So all of those things, you know, I'm open to have those conversations with whoever my real estate clients might be. And I've had them, you know, several times, you know, just helping people on that way to get mortgage ready. You know, getting mortgage ready is saying, hey, look, let's get your finances in order. Like, all right, let's stop popping bottles and buying tables every weekend because that ain't setting out kids or nothing. Yeah, it's cool. Right. It's fun, but pop a bottle in your basement after you buy this new house.
Right.
You know what
I'm
saying?
Yeah,
and that's what it's been like. So the market is cool right now. It was hot maybe about 3 months ago. When I say hot, I mean it was like a seller's market, like interest rates low. You know, sellers got 10 and 12, you know, offers, you know. So the real estate market was hot in D.C. and in Maryland. Right now in D.C. is slowing down a little bit. And these, of course, these are my personal opinions, just being out there in the market. The interest rates look like they're starting to go back up just a little bit. They're creaking up there. And all of that affects how much buying power you have. So, you know, but the market is still good. I like Maryland. You know what I mean? I like Maryland. I'm a DC native boy, third generation native Washington.
Right.
You know that. You know what I mean?
Right.
But I like Maryland because for me, I ain't got a fire truck in my backyard for one. Yeah. You know, but two, I get a little more space, you know, and you know, I kind of get to stretch out a little bit. You know, I don't have that anxiety if necessarily have to feel like I'm living with someone, if that makes any sense. And that's just for me, you know. Yeah. A lot of people, in my personal opinion, get caught up on the hype of, oh, all the houses in D.C. are going to be worth $1 million. Let me get in now if I won't be able to get in. Listen, if you buy a house in D.C., if you buy a house in Baltimore, Maryland, you buy a house in PG County, Montgomery County, home has to be home for you. Not because D.C. is a popular city right now, or it's the nation's capital. Great. Cool. I'm from there. I've been there majority of my life. I still work.
Right.
But make home for you, whatever state or city that might be. And so, you know, and a lot of people get stuck on DC and to the point where it's real. You get priced out, bro. You get priced out, you know, you get priced out because a lot of black and brown people can't afford to live in DC. Right. And that's heartbreaking, you know, because people still like urban lifestyle and stuff like that. But again, you can find that. They got urban lifestyle in Maryland, Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's other cities out there. So, you know, yeah, whatever real estate needs people need, man, I got you. I'm patient. Don't think you won't have to get up and buy this house tomorrow or 3 days from now. And if your credit's cooled up, start now. You know what I mean? Make a plan. And I got the lenders and stuff that are patient to work with you and talk you through, you know, the things that you need to know to buy the house, man. Like, again, I'm not going to push you or press you to buy anything like right away. I want you to find a home and make it home. So that's the difference between me and other real estate agents. I think is that I don't need your money to pay my mortgage next month.
Yeah, so got you.
I'm not about to sell you a bad house. Like, you know that janky car dealership?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not the janky real estate agent, I'm not the janky car salesman. You can take your time and buy the house that you really want, and it's gonna be a good house, a solid home that's not gonna fall down in the next 4 or 5 years, because I don't need your money to pay my mortgage next month.
I want
to buy the house that you want and be patient. I'm gonna be patient with you. So yeah, that's real estate, man, you know.
Yeah, man, real estate, man. That's that part of the water I ain't trying to go out and swim to. You know, I'd rather ask somebody else to go out there and swim. Look, out there for bring me back the fish.
Man, it's you can't lose, man. And if you got kids, like everybody, well, not gonna say everybody, but a lot of people who who have wealth hold their wealth in real estate. You know what I mean? I just read Rick Ross's new book, and I was down at the Revolt Summit, you know, and I thought his speech was going to be a little different, and not necessarily his speech, but, you know, his interview. But his interview was dead on, same dead on to what his book was, which was, hey, everybody else buy NFTs and cryptocurrencies. He said, I'm buying real estate. I'm buying real estate. I said, that's tried and true.
Yeah.
It's tried and true. It's going to go up. And people, guess what? People might not need things that they can buy, but people always need a place to live.
Mm-hmm.
So if you ain't living in yourself, somebody else is going to pay you to live there. You know, and you always need a place to live. So you can be a landlord or you're going to be a tenant, you know? And I just like to help people to see it that way. So that way they can make informed decisions, take their time and buy something and eventually become a tenant, you know? Well, they're a tenant now, but eventually become a landlord, you know, and then buy a next property. And then you got rental income, and then you don't need a job because now your kids is managing the rental income. It's like a whole situation. What they do.
It's a whole vision. It's a whole vision. Yeah, and that's something growing up we wasn't really accustomed to, is visions. You know, it was always month to month, day to day type thing.
It was, bro. Yeah, and we still ain't getting that enough. We still ain't really got a lot of access to those type of ideas or those type of visions. We don't. So I find myself reading a lot of audio books, man, and I like what our Black actors and entertainers are doing now. Like I said, Rick Ross, this is his second book. Kevin Hart's book, Steve Harvey's book, Will Smith's book that I just got finished reading. They tell about the struggle that they came through. They tell about the mistakes. They share an experience. This is something that I didn't get from my grandparents. They didn't share their downfalls. You know what
right,
I'm saying?
Right.
You know, we ain't get the journey. You know what I'm saying? We ain't get the true ups, you know? And so I like that they sharing that, so that way we know what it looks like and what it feels like if we approaching it. If we decide to take any of those roles that any of those actors, singers, entertainers, you know, have taken, whether it was in their field or their career, or whether it was in something else that they may be dabbling there in the business world, you know?
Yeah, man. So speaking of that, reading books, your literacy campaign, you know, explain to us, what's that all about?
Man, my son loves to read books. He's 6 years old. Little Helene, you know, I named him after my twin brother. It's a promise made.
Beautiful. That's beautiful, man.
So he was like, Dad, you know, free library. Oh, these little free libraries. So I seen the little free library. So I decided to look it up and see where was one was close to me. You know what I mean? Like, all right, cool. And I looked it up when I got to work. So I work in Ward 7 and Ward 8. My office, or so to speak, on my station is actually like, I think that's Ward 7. So I looked it up again while I was at Ward 7. And on the map, it shows you how many free little libraries are in that neighborhood. It was barely any. So I scanned out to see where all of the free little libraries was, because it tells you that there's millions of them, right? Mm-hmm. Well, most upper Northwest, you know? So I'm like, what?
Capitol Hill. A ton of them in Capitol Hill.
And so I'm like, dang. I said, what's going on here? I said, you know, I said, well, look. So I connected with some of the free library owners, you know, over in Ward 7 and Ward 8, and put some money in a book. You know, four different books, four different little libraries, and, you know, posted the flyer on my social media, and people went out and they got it. And they got rewarded, you know, they got rewarded with the book. They left a book, and they also got a free book. So, you know, it's encouraging reading, man. You know what I mean? Reading opens up the world. You know, it's like you get new ideas and new, you know, just a new sense of pride, especially when you see somebody that looks like you in a book. Because most of the time, you know, when we were growing up, it wasn't a lot of Black and brown books, right? You know, so yeah, so that was what the literacy campaign is about. And I'm hoping to do it every year, once a year, around this time of month. November is the month that I lost my twin brother, so it's one of the months that I really push out and give as much as I can, you know. So hence the coat drive, and I'm couple of other you know, things that I got working with, you know, I'm trying to give. I just gave away 10 vacations.
Yeah,
people need it.
I saw that. Yeah.
I didn't want to give away no turkeys, man. You know what I mean? Use your EBT card. I didn't want to give away turkeys. Yeah. You know what I mean? I wanted to give them something that I knew for me and for them that could be like a deep, take a deep breath. Mm-hmm. You know, go down. You know what I mean? You know, when you go to the mountains and stuff, the edge is different.
It's different, yeah.
It's different, it's bro. Different. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So, you know, leave the city for a minute. Go get some fresh air. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I gave away 10 trips to Massanutten up in the mountain ski resort. And, you know, I kind of got upset because when one person called, I guess, you know, I might have gave one over 10. I'm like giving. It's free. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I'm going right. to get to it. I mean, I gave one over and they turned her down. So I'm gonna work it out where she can get up. You know, she can work it. I'm gonna work it out so she yeah. can still, you know, her and her family. But that's the month of November, man. I'm giving. You know?
Yeah, man. Next man, put us down, raise on the Lab podcast, put us down. You know, definitely. If you need any help, because you know, we starting off. So that's one of the things that we do want to do is help you know, our communities and help.
Yeah.
Build each other up, you know what I'm saying? So you're an author. I mean, like, you're an author. That's something. I mean, you actually wrote a book, had it published. You're an author. Where are you at with that? Like, how many books do you have?
So I just released book number 4, which was The Twins Adventures of Dan Up the Park with Rocky the Doggy. That book was tough. Well, you know, and it was tough because I included this dog and kids love dogs. And mm-hmm. I wrote this last book. So this is book number 4, mm-hmm. Twins Adventures, A Day in the Park with Rocky the Dog. So it was book number 4, but the book was tough, but it was fun because kids love dogs. And I wanted to write this book, not only for kids, but for doggy parents.
Okay.
You know? Like, hey, man, let's go to the dog park and sit and get your dog a treat and read a book.
Mm-hmm.
You know, encouraging those parents that can't have those doggy parents that can't have kids and don't want to have kids just yet to kind of, you know, they already do everything else. They put sweaters on them.
Right.
I just think
they got
up yet, you know?
Them dogs, they have like health insurance and.
Yeah,
that type of stuff. Yeah,
$1 million dog pox.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know,
their pox better than my pox.
Yeah,
you know, yep. But no, you know. So you know, I wanted to jump into that market just a little bit, and I also attached Rocky treats, which was dog treats. So you know, getting in the dog treat business a little bit. I mean, because every single building you go to, bank you go to, grocery store you go to, that allow dogs, they got dog treats. Free bowl of dog treats. So mm-hmm. hopefully my dog treats to be in place of their dog treats.
Yeah, it's so good because a lot of places I've been more pet friendly, you know, especially with dogs. You know, people, I mean, like you said, man, literally million dollar dog pox.
Literally,
You know, they're knocking down buildings to put dog pox.
Yeah, man. Yeah. So yeah, I guess dogs need a place to play. As much as people need places to live, but it all goes back to real estate. It's land. I wish I owned the land and they spend all this money. Because if they spend $1 million to build the dog park, I want to know how much the land was, because ain't that much stuff in the dog park.
It's not like it's
you know
yeah. stuff they can play on and all that. It's just usually just grass.
Yeah, man. Hopefully they come and tell you my backyard at some point and I can charge you.
What else is there for Hakim to do? I mean, is this it? Do you have some more things down the line that you hoping to kind of get off the ground, or you can just kind of massage what you have now?
Yeah, we're still massaging what I got now. Like I told you, man, it's you know, living fast and you never know how much time you got, man. So I'm not stopping. What I'm working on now is I'm preparing my mind to work on a book for teenagers, man. Like, you know, because they really need some guidance, yo. Like, and they need it. They need it real. You know what I mean? They need it real. They need it uncut. You know, I'm doing some mentoring over at Kramer Middle School and one of the KIPP academies. And these young men, you know, it's not enough. I don't have enough time to like spend with them. You know what I mean? Like if it's 24 hours in a day, I wish I could be with these young men for 16 and really pour into them and show them like a different direction, because right now, a lot of these young brothers are lost. So I'm trying to work my mind around a direction for a book, a guide for teens, you know, and not just the young men, but I'm hoping to partner with a woman who really, you know, has maybe had a struggle similar to what mine was and made it out. And you know what I'm saying? And just open enough to share their mistakes. And you know what I mean? Because that's what it really is, sharing the mistakes and being honest with these youngins. Because them youngins, they know when somebody's faking. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah, most know definitely. When
you, you know what I mean? Or they call it capping. They know when you capping. You
yeah,
know
what I'm saying?
So, so that's next. You know, my niece, just grown like, before I reach out into the community and to the world, like family is really important to me. So my nieces okay. and nephews, you know, I've been helping them with their businesses, you know. So my niece started a beer company called Urban Garden Brewing, you know. And so
what's your niece's name?
Her name's Imani Collier. Right. And so I'm number one supporter. She was homebrewing in my backyard before we got all the permits and stuff that she needed to make it happen. So, you know, starting right at home, you know, and now she got a beer release next Wednesday down at Union Market, you know, and okay. I give you all the information for that. And it's canned, name on it, you know, all the stuff, you know, and it's just good to see those things, you know, happen. My two nephews helped them start a record label, you know, because family's always been into music, and they've been restoring and recovering some old music from the 60s and 70s. So
what's your nephew's name?
So my nephew is Anthony Tate and Akil Tate. Okay. And so Anthony goes by $2. He's one of those local rappers, but he's really getting into the business side of music now with this record. You know, and Akil, he makes beats. And I don't want to say just makes beats, because that seems like this man makes sounds. He has sounds, you know, use my resources to put him in the right, you know, in the right room with the right people so that they can learn, you know, about how these things work. You know, that's what it is, man. You know, connecting and making sure our offspring, you know, nieces, nephews, cousins, you know, brothers and sisters, you know, have as much as we do, you know.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, when we first started, it's all about building wealth, generational wealth, and that starts with your family. You know what I mean?
Dang.
That's good, man. Yeah, man, this has been good, man. I really appreciate you taking the time to come on, man. We're going to have to do this again.
First thing that's coming up is that coat drive. That coat drive, we need kids' coats, man, from age 5 all the way up to age 13, boys and girls. I know we got 30 kids already that we identified that really need coats, but it's always more. This is the second, well, not the second, it's probably about the fourth year that I've been doing this annual coat drive. But the past couple years, average 75 to 150 coats, you know. So if y'all can, you know, help out with that in any way, man, you want to donate a coat or two or three or four, you know.
Yeah. Give us some dates where we can take the coats. Is it pick up? Is it drop off?
Yeah. So call me if you want to drop them off, 202-577-7131. The coats that we collect now are going to be distributed on December the 17th in Northwest. And, you know, because of the COVID guidelines and stuff like that, we can't have a lot of people there to actually give out the coats. So myself and a couple of other good brothers from Warren Lodge number 8 been, you know, collecting coats and, you know, we're going to divide them up, you know, put them in sizes and deliver them to them kids, at least those 30 kids on December the 17th. So, yeah, that's my number, man. And if anybody out there, you know, wants to donate some coats and, you know, and these kids, and we ask for new coats.
Right.
And we ask for new coats because it's a difference. If you don't know that it's a difference, then like, yeah, it's a difference. It's nothing like seeing a kid, and it's happened year over year. It's nothing like seeing a kid open up a plastic and take the tags off and put on a brand new coat. Like,
yeah, man, just like toys. And I'm glad. And it's sad it had to be COVID. But you know, because of COVID, a lot of the toy drives, you know, they asking for, you know, toys that are still wrapped up. You know, basically, you know, new toys because of, you know, COVID or whatever, but it is something. It's something to be able to open up something that's brand new. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Especially but for kids.
I definitely appreciate y'all getting me out here on Red Zone, man. And, you know, yeah, I can't wait till next time to come back and chop it up with y'all, man. And, you know, if anybody needs to find me, you know, catch me on social media, so_by_tape, you know, anything that you need to know is right there. You know, it's just like, you ain't only going to see the work that I do in the community, but you're going to see some fun stuff too. You know what I'm saying? I like to pod a little bit, you know, but you're going to see houses, books, community work, everything, man. And if it's something that you're working on and you're looking for an investor, you know, I'm always open for, you know, new business opportunities. I like to make money, you know?
Yeah,
so
appreciate that.
You know, reach out to, let's connect people for it, you know?
Most definitely, man. Thank you again. That's author Hakim Tate. We appreciate you coming on Red Zone in the Lab. One hot, one beat, one sound, one love.
Thank you for listening to Red Zone in the Lab podcast. Please follow us on Facebook and Instagram. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at Red Zone in the Lab. And you can download our podcast at Spotify, iTunes, and Podbean. And please visit our website at redzoneinthelab.com. Thank you.